Hello, my name is Dr. Madison Oak. I am a vestibular physical therapist, aka the Vertigo doctor, and I'm really excited to talk to you today a little bit about the anatomy and the physiology of the vestibular system. So when we talk about dizziness and we talk about the vestibular system, so much of it is really misunderstood, both by your doctors, maybe by you as a patient or a person who knows someone going through dizziness. And I think that understanding where your vestibular system is, what it does, how it works, and all that good stuff is so important. So today we're going to quickly go over just the very basic anatomy and physiology of the inner ear. So I'm going to share my screen with you so that you can be able to see what is going on in your inner ear. So here we have a photo of our inner ear. Well, our ear as a whole, really. So your ear, the part that you can touch, if you really want to literally put your hand on your ear with me. This is your outer ear. And the piece where you can stick your finger in, right? And we know that goes all the way until our eardrum, which on this photo is this little purple part right here. That is our outer ear. It has the canal of our outer ear right here where sound is taken in by our ear. This is the intention of it. And it is put into our tympanic membrane or our eardrum. So sound hearing really starts from the outside of our ear. That's what that's for. And it gets to our eardrum, and then that's where the outer ear stops and the middle ear starts. And it's important to understand that we have all three of these pieces. So first we have the outer ear again, then we have our middle ear. Our middle ear is this part down here that looks like Florida, basically. And that part is our eustachian tube. And our eustachian tube is the part that pops when you're on an airplane or it open and closes. Sometimes it feels like it's stuffed up. Your ears are stuffed when you have a cold or you have allergies, something like that. That's that eustachian tube talking to you. So it's important to understand that this is supposed to be closed at baseline. So all the time it's shut. And when you go and swallow or you pop your ears, it opens really quickly and then closes. And all that does is it lets in and out air from our middle ear. So it regulates the pressure, because pressure and volume have a relationship, of air in your middle ear. Now, these little brown pieces right here are your incus, malleus, and stapes. And these are the three really teeny, tiny, tiny, tiny ear bones that will help you hear, right? It takes the vibrations that are out from your outer ear and pushes them in towards your cochlea through your middle ear into the inner ear, right? Now, the inner ear, and we're going to get another picture of this in 1 second, but I want to orient you first, is comprised of two things. First, you have your cochlea, which is right here, and then you have the vestibular system. Between the two of these, they share a nerve. It is called your vestibulocochlear nerve. And this nerve is basically just to transmit a signal from your vestibular system, the vestibulo part of the word, and your cochlea, aka your hearing organ, into your brain. Now, this is a cranial nerve. It's number 8. And that means it just comes directly from your brainstem out into some part of your head or part of your body. There are 12 of these. One you may have heard of before is your vagus nerve, but this one is your vestibulocochlear nerve. And that is number 8. And again, all it does is bring the signal from your inner ear to your brain, so your brain is better or even able to interpret the signals that it's being sent. Your cochlea, again, this is the hearing part of the organ, and the hearing part of your organ is the part that it looks like a snail, and you probably learned about it in high school biology class at some point, and then we're like, oh, that's how we hear, and we never really have to think about it again, right? Attached to its evil step twin, the vestibular system, and there are 3 semicircular canals, and there are the otolith organs inside. We're going to get another picture of this in 1 moment. So I'm just going to scroll down to the next photo. So next we have our vestibular system. And the vestibular system itself, remember, we are reorienting ourselves to this picture. So before it was that blue thing, it was kind of twisted, topsy-turvy in that photo. So it looked more like this. But just for argument's sake, we're gonna flip it to its space where it should be. Now, it's important to understand where the vestibular system is in the world. So we're going to zoom in again. And the vestibular system is this part on the left, okay? And I do want to say that in this drawing, this is a drawing that I own, but this pink part over here on the left should connect all the way in here. And I do not know why it doesn't. But just for anatomy's purposes, this should connect. And then this part over here will be closed in the next photo, but it's opened here just so you can see inside. Now, let's head over to the left-hand side. You have three of these canals. The first canal is the anterior semicircular canal, the one on the top. Then you have your posterior semicircular canal. It goes down here. And then the one in the center here, this is your horizontal or lateral canal. Now you have three of these and they detect angular motion. So if you spin in a circle, if you go to lay down in bed and kind of move your head one way or the other, anything that's an angular motion, and most motions we do are not directly angular or directly linear, but it's important to understand that the angular portions that we're sensing are sensed by this. And this is how it works. So inside of here, there are two kinds of fluid. And the fluid that we're going to focus on is your endolymph. And the endolymph is this kind of beigey pink color rather than the brown beige color. So you have it in each canal and each tube. And at the end of each of these is called your ampulla. Now your ampulla is this darker reddish brown color with this pink little diamond in it. Now, this ampulla is really important because that pinkish diamond is called your cupula. And all of these fancy words, we're gonna make them more basic here. And this diamond cupula part, we're gonna imagine is seaweed in an ocean. So this works by when you move your head to the right and you move your head to the left, your cupula moves right and left based on the fluid in the canal. So if you move your head to the right, the fluid moves left and vice versa, because it's going to move opposite because of inertia. Now, if you are spinning in a circle, each one of these canals, they have their own fluid and they detect their different motions. We're just going to talk about this lateral canal. If you're looking right and left, shaking your head, or you're moving in a circle, this cupula here is going to flow in one direction based on the way that you're spinning, and then it'll stop when you stop spinning. And that is how angular motion is detected. Now you also have linear motion detection, and I am going to scroll to the next photo for linear motion detection, because this is where the otolith organs come into play. I'm going to zoom this photo a little bit bigger. So in this photo here, we have a closed cochlea in this picture now, and the vestibular system again is on the left-hand side. This piece is still missing over here on the left for reasons I do not know. And then we have this extra thing up here. Now this extra thing at the top is a representation of how your otolith organs look. And all that means is the linear detectors are made up of three little layers. So on the bottom here, we have something called your hair cells. And the hair cells are attached to your nerve. This is a nerve, this yellow piece on the bottom. So it goes nerve on the bottom, hair cells. Then there's a little jelly layer. And then there's these crystals. So if you imagine sort of like grass sticking up, jello on top, or some gelatin substance on top, and then little sesame seeds or nerds or something on top of that. That's basically all this is. Now, these crystals are made out of calcium carbonate. They're similar structure to bone. And what they do is they detect linear motion. And all I mean by that is if you move forward, you go up and down, side to side, tilt your head forward, any of those motions, these crystals are pulled with gravity. So now when someone says, oh, you have ear crystals, Everyone has ear crystals. They're supposed to be there. They're super important. They respond to gravity. So in this picture, actually, technically the head is tilted forward in this picture because these crystals are falling forward. Okay. So this just means it's pulling these hair cells and sending the nervous signal that says, I'm looking a little bit forward or a little bit down. Now you have one of these that detects horizontal motion, so back and forth motion, and another one of these that's kind of shaped more like this, that detects forwards and backwards motion. So they're forwards and backwards and then up and down motion. They detect different things. And it's important to understand this because you just have two, one's called your utricle and one's called your saccule. And again, the names of these are not super important. You do not have to be to remember them. I will not be testing you on them. Do not worry. But basically this just lives inside this tiny little part called the otolith organs. Okay. These two otolith organs live in here. So hopefully now you understand better the anatomy. Remember, if we're going to scroll to the top here, we have the ear itself. So you have your outer ear, your middle ear, and your inner ear. That's the first part we need to remember. And then we have the vestibular system itself. We have endolymph and perilymph in here. Endolymph is the part that is going to push on the ampulla or the cupula through the ampulla in here. And then if we scroll down again, we're going to get to the linear motion detection system, which are your otolith organs. Now, hopefully that makes sense. If you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the comments. I'm more than happy to help. The next part I want to go over is how this actually sends a signal to your brain, because that's really important. Now, your brain has, or your head, I should say, has a vestibular system on either side of your head. And it's important to understand that our vestibular systems are working all the time. Now, right now, looking forward at you, I am looking forward. So both of my vestibular systems are sending a signal saying, I'm looking forward, I'm looking forward, I'm looking forward. When I look to the right, my right side fires more and my left side fires less. And it says, okay, now I'm looking to the right. And it just kind of sends this signal, and vice versa, all day long. It sends a different signal, looking up, looking down, right, left, depending on where I am. Now, if something goes wrong with this system, that's when we get dizzy. So something could either go wrong with the system itself, or we could have something wrong with the way we process the information. Now, that is just the difference between a peripheral vestibular dysfunction and a central vestibular dysfunction. Peripheral vestibular dysfunction being the actual vestibular system itself and that nerve has something going on with it. Central being the brain has something wrong with the processing of these signals. Now, these are two very different things. So for a peripheral dysfunction, like vestibular neuritis, is a really good example of a peripheral dysfunction. Now, that is when you have an infection in one side or the other. So if you have an infection on the left side and you have a left vestibulo hypofunction, which is also called a neuronitis, neuritis, vestibulopathy, all of those are sort of the exact same word, you're going to have a decrease in function in one side. Now, remember, your brain is used to this kind of a situation. But now, if you have an infection in one side and your brain is saying, okay, something's wrong because I know my neck is telling me, and my eyes are telling me I'm looking forward right now. But my vestibular system is sending a weird signal saying I'm looking to the right because the right side is firing more than the left side. Now, this is important because this is your new normal. This does not mean you're going to be dizzy forever. And that's one thing I want to be very, very clear about. You are not going to be dizzy forever, but this is your brain's new normal. Now, the amazing thing about the human brain is that it's incredibly plastic, meaning it can change all the time. So if this is your brain's new nervous system normal, where I have an infection in the side, we're not very good at regrowing nerves, but we are really good at regrowing pathways to our brain to do different things. So our brain is slowly going to learn that this is our new way to say, I'm looking forward. And so when you look to the left, the right one's going to fire less. The left one's probably not going to send that much of an excitement signal, maybe a little bit. When you look to the right, this one's going to fire more. This one's going to fire a little bit less. And it's going to say, okay, I understand now that this is my new normal. And I'm going to use this side to compensate. I mean, this is when you have a unilateral vestibulopathy or unilateral vestibular hypofunction. Works a lot different if you have both sides. But
in this case, you are going to relearn that this is your new normal. And that's what's such an amazing thing about your brain, is it's going to compensate when you have vestibular neuritis. Now, if you have chronic dizziness for a long time after vestibular neuritis, that's a discussion for another video. But in general, your brain will compensate. Now, if you have a central processing disorder, let's say vestibular migraine, for example, your vestibular system probably has nothing wrong with it. In most cases I see, you get that VNG, that video nystagmography test back, and you say, everything's normal, you should be okay. And you're like, I do not feel normal. This happens a lot in vestibular migraine because there's nothing wrong with the actual vestibular system itself. There's only something wrong with the way that your brain is processing this information. So imagine your brain is sort of like a cable television. So you have a cable box, right? You have the wire from the box to the TV, and then you have the TV. In this analogy, the cable box is your vestibular system. The wire is the vestibulocochlear nerve. And the TV is your brain, which is trying to make a picture from the stuff that's being sent. Now, if you have vestibular migraine, you have a migraine disorder that's making it difficult to understand what signals your brain is sending from the vestibular system. Now, vestibular migraine is a way bigger conversation than just that. But in this anatomy and physiology discussion, that's what we're going to leave it to. So your brain is sending these signals saying, I know where I am in space. I am all good. But when that signal is being sent, it's getting jumbled. So it's sort of like you have static on that TV. So in order to treat this, instead of just learning to compensate, these kinds of head shaking exercises probably are not going to be that effective for people. Instead, we want to do lifestyle modifications and functional activities that are going to make your life easier. So hopefully you understand a little bit better the anatomy and the physiology of the vestibular system, where it is in your head, how it works, and of course, a little bit about peripheral and central pathologies. I hope you have a great day. Again, like, follow, comment, subscribe to my channel to be alerted to our weekly new videos.